So welcome, we are here in Cape Town. We are meeting as the Scientific Program Committee of the Next Einstein Forum and Ames Robert Bosch Stiftung Initiative. With me this afternoon is Professor Jean-Pierre Bourguignon, a very familiar name in the circles of science in Africa. Currently, Professor Bourguignon occupies the post of the President of the European Research Council, the council that oversees and provides policy direction and guidance to the pan-European scientific agenda. Welcome, Professor.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
So we're here talking about the next Einstein Forum. To us, it's a platform that we're putting together where we will bring together policy makers, both European, American, but mostly African, it's an African initiative, policy folks, scientists, civil society, and the whole community to discuss how Africa can emerge scientifically. You occupy a very prominent role in European science. What does such an initiative mean to you? Not only do you occupy a very important role in European science, you're very, very involved in science in Africa. What does an initiative like that mean to you?
Well, first of all, I think the initiative is very welcome. I could see the importance in Europe of a similar initiative, which is not that long ago, that is 2004, where Euroscience created the Euroscience Open Forum. And the reason for this was really to realize that in America, the meeting of the AAAS, American Association for the Advancement of Science, was bringing together both scientists, policymakers, politicians, and so on, and to really be the main platform for discussion of the impact of science, the policy of science for the whole country, and actually much broader, because it was really the reference point. So the development in Europe of ESOF, Euroscience Open Forum, was very important. I was very pleased to be associated with it. I basically took part in the steering committees of all the ESOF meetings from the first day, and actually had to resign because now with my position can be considered a conflict of interest. But so you see, Europe has not been doing that for long. And I think I could see for Europe, I mean, the impacts of such a meeting. So I hope, and that's the ambition, and that's a very legitimate ambition, that the next Einstein Forum will do for Africa something similar. That is to bring on the same scene both scientists, policymakers, people from industry too, and to discuss really the new developments of society which are connected to science and technology in ways which have to do with knowledge, which have to do with training, which have to do with job development, and also commitment, because all of this can function, I mean, for science technology only if you take a broad enough and long enough perspective. And this, you have to convince politicians to adhere to that, and people from industry, they know that very well, because they cannot change their policy every second year or third year, which sometimes government tend to do that, because there's always some immediate pressure which push them to change their policy. So I think I'm very, very hopeful that what I could see in Europe, and I was very proud to be part of the team which participate in this. It was not connected to my job. I took this position at the European Research Council only a year ago. Maybe just one point I want to make is not to be confused. I mean, the European Research Council is just a program of the European Science, the European Commission. We don't have the responsibility of advising the Commission on this. We have the responsibility of supporting science at the highest level, and actually the originality of the program, which is something I think to be considered, is that it's the only program in which the scientists are really in the driver's seat. That is, we are the ones who decide how to spend the money, and we are the ones to decide how we evaluate the project. And that's a very major responsibility, in particular because the amount of money put at our disposal is quite significant. And as a result, we have an impact, and actually we already have a very, very significant impact. So, but you see, this was a long struggle, because it was not natural for people from the Commission or politicians to empower scientists for such decisions. But finally, we managed to convince them that we were the right people to do that. Of course, next to this program, there are other programs which are top down, but this one is strictly bottom up. That is, we really are in charge of motivating the scientists to really develop the research at the highest possible level.
So that would sound like the European equivalent of what in the US we would call the National Science Foundation. Is that?
Yes, in a sense you can say so, except, yeah, sure, you can say so, except in the case of US, first of all, National Science Foundation doesn't cover humanities, for example, there's a separate thing. And also in the case of the US, the contracts, I mean the grants that people receive, tend to be less focused on young people as we have. I mean, the European Research Council has decided very early on to dedicate 2/3 of its resources to young people. Say people within 30 and 40, and also our mechanism tend to be simple. We are just, I mean, it's a very new institution, just 7 years old, almost 8 years old now, and so therefore we still have to learn and probably to get stronger and broader. But what has been remarkable is that in a very short time, the institution established it as a reference worldwide. So I think we can be very proud of that. I can say this because I was not in charge, so my predecessors did a good job, I think.
So the next Einstein Forum that we're participating in here is coming at a time when Africa itself is increasingly demanding its own scientific manpower and developing policies and programs that is showing intent and effort at developing its own scientific enterprise. And Europe is surely a little more advanced. But Europe wields very, very heavy influence in Africa, historically, but in almost every dimension. And you would often hear complaints from the African political or street guy about European influence in Africa. But science is an area where diplomacy, scientific diplomacy is an area where lots of bridges have been erected even between enemies and between people who normally complain one against the other. How do you see Africa's efforts at emerging scientifically being complemented by European scientists, more along the lines of, say, science diplomacy or collaborations or anything like that?
Well, maybe for this, let me rely on my own experience as a mathematician. I mean, it turns out my first PhD student was Beninese. Actually, Jean-Pierre was my PhD student. And so this was my first opportunity for me to connect with the African mathematicians. And actually, so that's the reason why I've been visiting various African countries in this context. And what I witnessed was really, Jean-Pierre was, I think, really the first Beninese to get a PhD in mathematics. Now there are many more, and many good ones. And I've seen some countries which are really now are producing and really actually bringing to a level which is completely comparable to some European countries. I'm just talking about mathematics. Senegal is one of them, but they are Cameroon also has really made remarkable progress. Not even talking about South Africa, which already had a strong basis. And I could witness that also by evaluating some programs in Africa. I was evaluator of the mathematics department at Pretoria University, which was actually a fantastic experience because of the quality of the people, the dedication, and the ambition. So I think there is definitely the basis in Africa, and in particular the situation has really changed in 20 years' time remarkably. And because they are already, when I'm talking about Africa, I'm really talking about sub-Saharan Africa. Of course, the Maghreb and the northern part of Africa is a different story, which also has, again talking about mathematics, very strong countries like Tunisia or Morocco have really very highly developed communities and really producing people now at a level which is very comparable to some of the European countries. So from that point of view, the situation is not that Africa, again, I'm basing my judgment on mathematics, is as to learn everything. I mean, it's already, a continent which is producing knowledge at a very, very good level and with, structures in place and competent people in place and also some mechanisms which are very interesting where some countries also share the promotion because when a country is too small, it's very difficult to take enough distance from one you want to promote people. So I know some countries are sharing mechanisms to decide collectively, I'm talking about African countries, how to promote people, which I think is a very sound way because the worst for scientists is really I mean, being too close community, because then you don't know how to judge, properly, fairly, people who are too close to you. It's always something difficult. You have to take some distance. Yeah, you could be some bias. But also, it could also mean that people concentrate too much on too narrow areas. You need to be to open up. And that was really one thing I welcomed very much with Ames, which was really the idea of mixing young people coming from completely different backgrounds, and so that they can see there is a much broader variety than what they have been exposed to, but also creating a network of these people, so they know each other, they can contact each other, they can help each other, they can start to work again together later on. So I think this this movement, which go into both directions, that is broadening but still networking, is something which is very critical for the development of science. And all instruments of the nature like AIMS, but there can be many others, can be really very, very important. I also witnessed the development of the African Mathematical Union, which preceded the European Mathematical Society. So I was president of the European Mathematical Society. That was another reason why for me to visit Africa and to see. One point you mentioned in passing, which I think is very important for the future of Africa, is to be able to surmount the division which is left, has been left by Anglophone and Francophone countries. And I think this can only happen through respect. That is, both communities have to respect each other and probably find the right mechanisms to have balance between the two inheritance. And I know for some countries, in that case of Benin, which has many different languages, that at some point French was also being used as some kind of a neutral language. It's not the case in some other countries where the really local language was really naturally dominant and normally dominant. But so there are always this very different situation, different inheritance from the past, about the colonial past, which I think I'm sure Africa is surmounting now, because the development and particularly the resources which are in Africa, and particularly the youth which is there, is a fantastic element, basis for the future.
All right. Well, thank you, Professor Jean-Pierre Bourguignon. We very much appreciate your coming on board. We are extremely encouraged when scientific leaders like you see a scientific vision for Africa. Your activities over so many years give us hope that our shared humanity, Africa and Europe, Africa and the rest of the world, the whole globe, can indeed hold hands for a common enterprise. We look forward to working with you through this NEF journey. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much for the invitation, and also for the wonderful hospitality. Thank you.